So in, pull it back to say an example of a property transaction, and I'm in the middle of one at the moment, and we've got to negotiate the purchase of a site. And I always think of, there's going to be the vendor wants this, which is all the way up here. The buyer wants this, which is all the way here. How do we get to the point of here and it's an agreement? We talk about, and you've probably read the book many times, getting to yes, getting to your BATNA. And is that one of the tools that you sort of use as well?
Sure. So, So plan your negotiation is the first thing I'd say. So work out what's your aim high point, what's your good point, and what's your absolute bottom limit point. And you need to be very clear on that. You need to do that before you start the negotiation. So you've got a very clear plan. I'm going to go in at this particular price point. When I say aim high, if you think about it as buying, well, that's actually buy it for as low as you can. Does that make sense? So if you're going to sell, then aim high being sell it for as high as you can. Aim high in the sense of buying means buy it for as cheap as you can. So you want to set your various parameters and start. And then, but you've also got that point where that is your absolute walk away point. The two key tools to be successful in selling is questions and listening. Now, again, you go back to why is there such a negative connotation around salespeople? Because in the old days, salespeople had the gift of the gab. They would talk, 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 talk. They'd be slippery people, and there'd be very little listening, but they'd be schmoozing and looking to persuade you. Whereas today, in 2019, and it hasn't just started in 2019, it's all around asking questions and listen and listen and listen and really understand with the person that you're negotiating with, what is it that they want? Where are they at? What's important to them? So again, in a property negotiation, is time important to them? Is price important to them? There's some other terms that are important to them. What is it that's important to them? Do they want to be able to rent back, for example, for a period of time? Again, this comes from questioning, 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 and listening. And ideally, in regards to the ratio of listening to talking, you want it to be 4 to 1. So listen 4 times as much as you talk. Now, worst case scenario, you've got 2 ears and 1 mouth, so do it, twice as much listening. But the reality is, if you can push it out to 4 to 1, right? So that is really concentrate on spending more time asking a question and then sitting back and listening for the response, and then starting to formulate things. And also with the negotiation, you don't have to rush things as well. Control the tempo of the negotiation. Right, depends upon in which position you're in, but you can just control the tempo, slow things down if you think things are going a little bit too quick, or speed them up if you think they're going a little bit too slow. But really look to take the driving position in that negotiation. But again, that's through questioning, through listening, through understanding what's important, and also knowing in your mind that you've gone and spent the time actually plotting out. What are my various points that I need to start with? What's an acceptable point, and what's my absolute walk away point?
Yeah.
And you see it
So
all the
there's a bit
time
of
with
planning.
auctions. Yeah, 100%. I mean, it's you talk about the skills of effective salespeople. I've just touched on two of them being listening and questioning. Planning, empathy is another one. Being patient. Obviously, mindset. Mindset applies to everything, not just to selling, and we go through that every week. So, in the spirit of trying to mix up what we talk about, but absolutely spend a lot of time planning the questions that you're going to ask, planning how you would respond. So, try and preempt the types of questions that are going to come across the desk at you. How would you respond to those? Like, take a lot of time in trying to craft out. How it is you're going to respond, what you're going to say. Doesn't mean you're going to get them all right. Doesn't mean that you're going to be able to preempt every single question that comes your way. But here's the thing. If you get a question that is a question that you don't have an answer to, don't BS anyone. Say, I don't know. I haven't got the answer, but I'll come back to you if I close the business today with a response. There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with acknowledging the fact you don't have an answer. And here's the other thing with that. is that if you experience a situation where you're asked a question and you don't have an answer, A, you'll go back to them perhaps by the end of the day with a response, but B, you'll always have an answer for that moving forward. And this is like anything, right? It's about building the muscle. So the more conversations you have, the more dialogue you have, et cetera, then you will build the muscle to have those various conversations.
So what a good, and it would mainly be, and say, you know, our audience would be, I would say majority are buyers, and they're looking to purchase sites, you know, purchase projects and all that. How do they, what are good tips for them to be able to negotiate the best outcome, obviously for themselves, but still be able, you know, what are some good tips to be able to approach real estate agents or vendors by presenting themselves in the best light, but be able to still say, you know, I'm trying to be able to create the best outcome for you. It's self-serving, right?
So quite often with real estate agents, we want to go in low. So as developers, we want to obviously go in and low. We want to buy that property for the very best price we can. A lot of times, a real estate agent may not fully understand all the costs involved in developing. And so it comes to them as a shock because in their mind, something might be worth $700,000 and you've come in at $550,000 and you haven't just, you know, plucked the number out of the air. And so my advice is actually take an agent through it. Actually say, you know what, I'm more than happy to take you through how I've come up with this particular number. And if I haven't got something right, then let's have a chat about it. Does that make sense? And so you might say, well, look, I'm basing it off, land sales price of, you know, let's say $400,000 a block if we're doing a 1-to-2, right? So I'm basing it off that. I'm basing it off these operational costs. I'm basing it off my infrastructure charges, so on and so forth. So be very transparent with stuff and you know, help the agent understand, because in a lot of cases, the agents don't know what's actually involved in property developing. They don't realise all of the costs. The other thing too is don't forget about the P word, profit, right? We're not doing this for fun. We're doing it because we're here to make some money. And so we're entitled to communicate the fact that we're a business.
Sure. And what are good ways, and I've dealt with vendors directly, in terms of sales letters, this is a live example here where I've had, I've done a lot of letter dropping before speaking to vendors, and I believe you have as well. What are effective ways of writing letters that trigger interest in a vendor to actually bring back?
Well, let me answer it this way. When I'm doing letters, and at the moment, let me be transparent, I'm trying to sell a heap of stuff, right? So I'm not doing it. I haven't done any letters for a while, working my way through two very big projects. But it's all about test and learn. So that is that rather than trying to second guess what people will, how they'll respond, you want to come up with slightly different scenarios. It might be the copy. It might be handwritten versus typed. It might be a handwritten envelope. It might be dear homeowner versus to the direct person. There's different nuances that you can do. What I talk about is test and learn. So test and learn being, if you're going to send out 100 letters, and I'm just going to use some arbitrary numbers here, you might do three different letters, so 33 each, or one of them is obviously 34. Send them out. What's the response rate? So rather than you try and work out what's the best type of letter, because different letters will work. The other example is, do you send it as an individual? Do you send it as a company? So you send them out and then you track them. So what I do, spreadsheet, I've got all 100 addresses, the date that I sent the letters, and then the letter type. And it could be as simple as A, B, and C, and I know what A, B, and C means. Does that make sense? And so then what I'm doing is I'm tracking the responses. And what I might find out of that is that letter B might actually be the winner. So whatever letter B is, and it could be very basic. Remember that the ultimate objective of sending a letter is to get the phone to ring. Right. So if you reverse engineer that process, that's the ultimate objective of sending a letter, is you want the phone to ring. And so just through test and learn, you want to work out what's the right type of letter. Here's the other thing with all this, Cheryl. You know that I've got, I love my drawings, right? So I brought along some stats for everyone.
Awesome.
Because when I talk about letters, people will tell me, oh, it doesn't work, Tony. So my response is, well, how many letters did you send? Oh, I sent one. Well, so here's something here that I've prepared earlier. This is from Salesforce. I've got to do it this way for you guys, don't I? This is from Salesforce.com. One of the world's leading sales companies. But this applies to contacts, right? So what happens is 44% of businesses stop after one contact. Now, this is not in regards to property development letter writing. This is just general business contact, right? 22% of businesses stop after 2%. 14% of businesses stop, 22% of businesses stop after two contacts. 14% of businesses stop after three contacts. 12% of businesses stop after four contacts. 8% of businesses last to five or more contacts. And here's the kicker. And that's where 80% of the sales happen. Does that make sense? And so what that means, we talked about it before around persistence and consistency and determination and patience and all these wonderful things. Guess what? It applies for sales as well. It applies for sales. Don't send one letter. Hope like crazy that it's going to work. Now, I'm not saying that it won't work because it could. Is it possible? Yes, it is. However, don't send one letter and go, oh, Tony, this doesn't work. Rather, as you could see by the stats, that 80% of sales actually happens at the fifth or more contact, but yet only 8% of businesses actually make their way through that. And I'm actually preparing this... I've got my biggest client is a large franchise, a national franchise group, and I'm presenting at their conference shortly. And I'm actually, that's one of the slides that I'm going to take them through because, you know, they'll be doing maybe flyers or, you know, different activities to try and generate new leads, new business. And they'll do it once or twice and they'll stop. And so my point is, guys and girls, you need to persist with this. You need to keep going. And you will be successful. And so going back to the letters, you want to constantly do letters. And so I say to my students, do you want to send a letter every 2 or 3 months? Because someone's situation today might be that they're not ready to sell. So remembering that when you go direct to vendors through letters, you're dealing with people who perhaps haven't thought about selling. And so you're wanting to get them to open up to the thinking of selling. Whereas when you're going to an agent, then typically they're dealing with people who want to sell, right? So going to an agent can be a shorter term piece. Letters can be a longer term piece. And so you're in it for the long haul. And so someone's situation is that today I'm not ready to sell, but thank you very much. In 2 or 3 months, there's another letter. And perhaps it's a slightly different letter to the first one. Perhaps it tells a little bit of a sequence. But there it is again in 2 or 3 months, another letter. Maybe you get nothing back from that. Maybe for them the situation hasn't changed. But here's the thing, you send another one in 2 or 3 months' time after that, which is effectively 6 months from now, and guess what? Maybe things have changed, and maybe because you're the person who's sent three letters by that stage, you're the person who's at the top of the pile, right? Yeah. But here's the other way to look at it. What's the alternative? If you don't send the letter, then you're not near the top of the pile. Right, and the same applies for social media. So I do multiple posts on social media every single day. The alternative is, if I don't do any posts, well, no one knows about me. So I'm constantly doing things, and whether people choose to like it or not, that's entirely up to them. But the point for me is that we are constantly doing something every single day, multiple times a day. So the same with your letterbox letterbox drops, is every 2 or 3 months, another and another and another. And if you go back to this here, it's the fifth contact, right? It's the fifth contact. So you want to set yourself up for the long haul. And that's about managing your expectations. Don't think for a moment that you're going to send one letter and be inundated with responses, because you won't. And the reality too with letterbox drops is that you're looking at about a 5% return. And of those, so if you send 100 letters, you're going to get five contacts back. If you send them directly, then the first two will probably be abuse. So it'll be abuse for how'd you get my details and blah, 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 all the good stuff. If you haven't sent me letters and you haven't been abused, then I encourage you to send a letter to get the abuse. It's very good for character building. So that's the first thing. You'll get so that'll be two of them. Perhaps one of them will be a tire kicker, and maybe two of them might be remotely interested, not really, out of your 100. And so if you think, well, 5% is the industry average, then if you want to have 50 responses, you send 1,000 letters. But within 1,000 letters, again, do what I said, regards to come up with different types of letters that have some slight differences, and then you can start to work out what seems to resonate and what doesn't.